Oh, Granny United, are you ready? Man, what an incredible Warriors conference we had. There's energy all over Granite this weekend. And the energy's not done because you know what we have? We have a primetime Kingdom Impact player coming today to speak to us. My brother from another mother. Many consider us twins. I love this guy. He has spoken many times here at Granite United. He's a big part of my life, a big part of our church's life. It is my friend, my brother from Warehouse Church, Pastor Eddie Trinkle. Granite, would you put your hands together and welcome Pastor Eddie to the pulpit? Come on, somebody.
Granite United in the house. Wow, it's so good to be here with you today. I got to tell you, Granite, we love your church. I know you guys are coming off of your Super Bowl week with your Shine Conference and with the Warriors last week at Waterville Valley. Everybody was up there and had a happy time. I know it was a phenomenal, phenomenal time of inspiration, of life change for your church and many churches throughout New England. I love coming up to the Warriors Conference, and I got my Crooked Warriors t-shirt on today for this special weekend that we're in. I always love spending time with my buddy, your pastor. If you know me, you know how close your pastor and his amazing wife are to me and my wife, Kim. We've been friends for 40 years, which doesn't seem possible, but if you know how old he is, it is possible. I'm just a lot younger than him, so it's hard to really to think through that. But in all seriousness, church, we love your pastor. Let's give up Pastor and Anthony some love this morning and his awesome wife. We love, love, love them. We honor them. And I count it a high, high privilege to be part of your services throughout the weekend at Granite United. I'll tell you something else I love. I love this series that you're going into called Bold. Because I don't know if there would be something better to talk about than the boldness of your witness, of your testimony, boldness in your giving, can I get an amen? Boldness in your love. I mean, so many different ways that God's called us. And you're coming off of, like I said, your Super Bowl weekends. Your ladies are all juiced up, pumped up, ready to charge hell with a water pistol to get people out of there and help them get saved. I know your guys are super juiced from Warriors and had such a great time. And now we take all this, right? We got to take all this inspiration and turn it into action. We got to take all this hype of these great, great weekends and turn it into delivering hope to people. So what I want to talk to you about today, I called my talk this, Can I Get a Witness? Now, I know there's some of you out there that know who Grand Funk Railroad is. And if you know who Grand Funk Railroad is, you know the lead singer, his name was Mark Farner, who later became a believer and actually took this song, Some Kind of Wonderful, and turned it into a Christian song. But part of that song goes, Some Kind of Wonderful, Some Kind of Wonderful. And one of the tags in the song, it's very famous, is, Can I Get a Witness? Sing it, church. Can I Get a Witness? Oh, yeah, you're tracking with me today. Well, that's what I called my talk today, Can I Get a Witness? So what I want to share with you, I want to kind of give you these opening thoughts this morning before we look in the book of Acts and talk about a story of two guys named Peter and John. Much to nobody's surprise, I've testified in court many, many times in my life. Anybody else have been to court and have testified before? Okay, all over the room. I am not surprised by that, just as much as you're not surprised that I have also. But one of the things that happens is you go up on the stand and one of the court security guards comes up to you and with a Bible or not with a Bible, I know some states aren't using the Bible anymore for that, but they say to you, do you swear to tell, say it with me, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole right truth and nothing but the truth, and that's just to help you God. And you got your hand up in the air, your left hand's on the Bible, and you say, I do or I will. And then you sit down and they start to ask you questions. And the questions they ask you will be directed towards an experience that you have been through that's relevant to the court there that day. They're not going to ask you about childhood and growing up and all. They're going to ask you, for whatever reason that you're in court there that day, if somebody's being sued or if there's a criminal act that you've seen or an accident that you've seen. I was in a horrible accident when I was 18 years old, and I got sued. 4 years later, I was in court. And I got called up and I went through that whole exercise that I shared with you today. And thank God the accident wasn't my fault and I was exonerated of everything. But what I had to do that day, when I put my hand on the Bible, raised my hand up in the air, swore to tell the truth, I had to give a firsthand account of everything that I witnessed. You see, that's what a witness is. You know, we think about witnessing as Christians. We think about maybe different religious groups that, you know, do some door knocking or hand out some religious material, and that's witnessing, or going up to somebody in a marketplace and just telling them about Jesus, or even sitting down with your friends, right, and talking to them about how they can accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. But this idea of witnesses is this: you are giving a firsthand account of something that you've personally experienced. Can I get a witness this morning of how many people have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ at Granite United today, right? That's right. You know Christ as Savior, and you could share that moment, maybe not the date and time if it's been a while, but that moment that you realize that you needed to be forgiven, you needed a Savior, and you called upon the name of the Lord and you were saved. You can give a witness to all of the circumstances in your life that led to that. Maybe you're going through some triumphs. Maybe you were going through some tragedies. Maybe you were having some marriage situation. Whatever the story is, your salvation story, you telling your salvation story, is you giving a witness of what Jesus Christ has done in your life. And you know, here's the thing about being a witness. Jesus told us just before he left and went back up into heaven, in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse number 8, he said, I'm going to give you power, and the Holy Spirit's going to come upon you, and you're going to be witnesses to me. He commanded them to be witnesses of what he did. They saw him alive, they saw him die, and they saw him alive again. You give a testimony that I'm alive, and I did all of this to forgive people of their sins, right? He said, you'll be witnesses to me, and then he gave him a roadmap: Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and everywhere, to the uttermost parts of the earth. He not only told us to be witnesses, he told us to be prepared to give a witness. In 1 Peter 3:15, it says, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready. That's our theme for Warehouse Church this year, being ready. We want to be ready to give an answer of the hope that lies within us in meekness and fear. We want to, in our church, be ready to receive guests that come into our church. We want to be ready for those holy appointments that God gives us in our neighborhoods, in our workplace, or out socializing to invite people to church. We always want to be ready. I ask our people in our church all the time, do you got your cards on you? Are you passing your cards out? Are you leaving your Warehouse Church invite cards when you're leaving a great tip? And by the way, this is a freebie. If you're going to leave a Granite United Church card when you go out and eat, you better be given a minimum of 25% tip. And I know everybody that waits tables in this room will clap on that one this morning. But don't ask them to come to church if you're not going to be generous. And here's a little freebie for you. Your tipping is not based on their service. It's based on your generosity. So you could take that as a freebie this morning, and I don't even need you to take me out to lunch for that one. That's just good word right there. But let's get to our story, how God wants us to be witnesses to him by giving a firsthand account of all that he has done in our lives. So let me read a story for you in Acts chapter 3. God's holy word says this. Now Peter and John went together at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a certain lame man from his mother's womb, that means he couldn't walk from the time that he was born, was carried. And he laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask for alms, or for people to be generous to him so he could have some money for those people that entered the temple, right? You think it's a strategic place, laying outside in front of the religious building, hoping that religious people will be generous to him and help him with some of his financial needs. And then the Bible says in verse 3, he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, and he asked them for money. And they fixed his eyes on him with John. Peter said this, look at us. And he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. And then Peter said, silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have I'm going to give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. And he took him by the right hand, lifted him up, and immediately his feet and even his ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. So you know that this guy was pumped up. Born without any ability to walk. He was a man, so maybe 25, 30, even could have been older than that. He's laying outside of the temple. He's hoping people will be generous to him. Peter and John said, I don't have any money, but here's what we're going to do. In Jesus' name, you're not lame anymore. In Jesus' name, you're going to have strength in your legs. In Jesus' name, get up and walk. And the Bible says he did. And then he went into the temple with them. And he's showing everybody. And all these people saw this guy. If they had been to the temple, they probably, a lot of those people went there every day. They saw this guy. Look, I can walk. And they're going into this religious place, and they're being quiet. People are off in prayers and kind of taking on that weird religious stuff that people do and meditating or doing whatever. And here's this guy. Dude, you just saw me a minute ago. Look, I can walk now. And he's going crazy. And because he was growing crazy, people said, man, you got to stop, man. You got to chill. You got to relax a little bit. And Peter and John were actually, because of this man's healing, arrested for this. Because it was said by the religious leaders that they were causing all of this uproar in the city. These same people that arrested and were responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. They arrested Peter and John. They put them on trial. And they said to them, why do you think you can do this? Man, they questioned this guy. They questioned his parents. And all this thing, trying to figure out how he got healed. And the Bible says this. This is how Peter and John responded to them in Acts chapter 4, the very next chapter. Then Peter, who was led by God, filled by the Holy Ghost. And I want to tell you something. When you are standing up for Jesus, you make sure you're fessed up, prayed up, and ready. Because Satan's going to come after you a little bit. And he's going to tempt, and he's going to try to seek, kill, and destroy. Because he doesn't want the name of Jesus going out. And he wants you to be discouraged. So Peter, wisely filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to this helpless man, by what means he has been made well, let it be made known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, now listen to this, who you crucified and God raised from the dead, by this man, by him, this man stands before you whole. This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given amongst men whereby we must be saved. When I look at this verse, I kind of think about Peter getting his chance to be bold again, right? After he denied Jesus three times. And now he gets a chance to take a stand for Jesus Christ. And he wasn't going to mess this opportunity up. And the thing I love about this is almost like a sports moment, right? Somebody gets the ball. Let's say in the Eastern Conference Finals, it's going to be the Sixers against the Celtics. How many of you would like that to happen? I would love for that to happen. I don't know if it's going to happen. But let's just say that happens. And at the end of the game, game seven, Joel Embiid, of course, I'm going to say the Sixers guy, right, gets the ball. He reaches up to take a shot or to get that last tip in at the end to win. I kind of feel like that tip in bucket at the buzzer is what this verse represents. Peter said this, I don't care what any of you people think. You may think it's this reason this guy got healed. You may think it's this reason this guy got healed. But let me tell you how he got healed. Jesus of Nazareth, the guy that you crucified, the guy that you wrongly tried, the guy that you illegally convicted, the guy that you illegally crucified, even though you didn't take his life from him, he laid his life down for us. Yeah, he's the one by whose power this guy is made whole. And he said to them, and there's no other way you can have, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given amongst men. Ready? Swish. End of the game. The winner is whereby you must be saved. What a great verse that is. And then in verse number 13, the Bible says that these religious people are kind of observing and going, what in the world has gotten into these two knuckleheads? Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and were kind of, they perceived that they were untrained and ignorant men, they marveled or they were surprised. Listen to this testimony. This is what they said about Peter and John. They recognized that Peter and John had been with Jesus. Would to God, Granite United, my folks at Warehouse Church in Plano, Texas, would to God that our testimony is that when people see us, man, they've been to Shine Conference. Man, they must have been to Warriors Conference. Look at those big W shirts. We see them everywhere. Or they've been with Jesus. They're not who they were. They don't talk the way that they used to. They don't drive the way that they used to. They don't communicate to society by the way that they look, the way that they used to. They're just different. Old things are passed away, and all things become new. Why? Because they had been with Jesus. And may that be our testimony today, church. When they saw the boldness of Peter and John in verse number 13, and saw that they were untrained and ignorant men, they realized that they had been with Jesus, and seeing the man who had been healed was standing with them. Like, you couldn't even argue that. Like, the guy who was laying at the gate, lame, disabled, was standing next to Peter. So every argument they had, well, that's not true. He's not really healed. This is phony baloney. This is that. The evidence of what happened was standing right next to them. And they could say nothing against it at the end of verse 14. But when they had commanded Peter and John to go outside, they kind of had a holy huddle. Oh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Verse 16. What are we going to do with these guys? Because a notable miracle has been done by them. It's evident. And to all that dwell in Jerusalem, everybody saw it, and we can't deny it. But so this message of Jesus spreads no further. Here's the decision we're going to come up with. Let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no name, they no longer speak in his name. So they called them and commanded them not to speak at all in the name of Jesus. Now, they were speaking from the authority of, if you don't listen to us, we're going to have you put to death, just like we did this character Jesus you talked about. We can't argue. We saw the lame guy. He's healed. We get it. And we're going to give you some mercy, right? They're kind of coming from a standpoint of mercy, which is taking away some deserved punishment from their standpoint. And they said, the only thing you got to do is stop talking about Jesus. Man, shine ladies, warrior guys, I guarantee you, you don't want to stop talking about what Jesus Christ has done in your life. And listen, you didn't have to go to either of these conferences. I know not all of us were able to. But if Jesus Christ has done something in your life, you're going to want to tell people about it. And that's what Peter and John's response was. Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than him, you be the judge. And listen, this is great. This is like this John 3:16 anthematic size, huge thematic value of the whole New Testament in this phrase in Acts chapter 4, verse number 20. We cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. So let me give you some things this morning to help you, all the families of Granite United, be a bold witness for Jesus Christ. And here's the first thing. How do I be a bold witness? Number one, know that you believe. Very simply put, in Acts chapter 16, verse number 31, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Know that you believe. Now, I'm saying that for a couple of reasons. First of all, know that time where, and maybe some of it happened at Shiner Warriors Conference. Maybe it happened at church this year. Maybe it happened when you were out at a life group this year. Maybe it happened when one of your family members told you about Jesus. I don't know when your day of salvation was, okay? But know what happened that day. Know that you acknowledged that you were a sinner. Know that you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Know that you confessed his name to God and invited Jesus to come into your life. And know that that happened in your life. And here's the other reason. Not only know that that happened, but know that that can't change. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 11, this is the testimony. Testimony means this is the word of God, or this is the truth. That God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Now listen to how simplistic this is. He that has the Son has life, eternal life. You have Jesus in your life, you have eternal life. He that doesn't have the Son of God does not have life. So if you believe in Jesus, the Bible says you have eternal life. If you don't believe in Jesus, then you don't have eternal life. You know what else that means? All these other religions in the world that tell you to do this, and be good, and believe in this system, and believe in that system. Denominationally, all these different things that people say, just be good, treat people right. And those are values, right? Those are values that aren't wrong, but they are not the entrance way to heaven. The only way through heaven to heaven is what Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse number 6. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he says this, nobody has access to the Father except through me. And he said this in 1 John 5:13. These things I've written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God. If you believe in the name of the Son of God, say amen. Come on now. I know how you guys get loud. If you believe in the name of the Son of God, say amen. All right, that's better. Now listen to this. He says this so that you may know that you have eternal life. Are you checking out what's happening here this morning or today? The Bible says that if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then you know that you have life forever. And the beautiful thing about that is God didn't save you for a season. God saved you for eternity. And he wants you to know that. And the Bible says we can have this confidence in him, that the one that began this good work in us will be faithful and completed, as it says in the book of Philippians. So the first thing is know that you believe. Know that you believe in Jesus Christ. And here's the second thing. Know what you believe. Now this goes into the boldness of our witnessing. The boldness of our witnessing. 1 Peter 3:15, I read it to you early. It says, but sanctify, that means grow in the Lord, no more. Stay in your Bible, stay in your life group, stay in church. Listen, we need community. We need our church. We need brothers and sisters around us. We need encouragement. We need to know that we're fighting with each other, not against each other, but we're on the same side fighting for the same cause, the cause of Jesus Christ. And this is a very military, there's a military tone in this verse. He says, sanctify the Lord God in your heart and be ready always to give an answer to everybody that asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, but do it with meekness and fear. Your mess turns into his message. A couple years ago, and you've heard me say this before if you've been in church, I had the privilege of going to the Super Bowl when the Eagles beat who in that Super Bowl 52? Yes, the New England Patriots, right? So don't shut me off here. And I was sitting next to a Patriots fan the whole game. And at the end of the game, he was gruff and mad. He was actually sitting by himself. And I was sitting with my brother Joe. And we stood up. And I'm telling you, at the end of that game, I was a big baby because we're not used to these Super Bowl things that you guys are used to, right? With the quarterback that retired and is now living in Florida, all right? Okay. But I remember standing. I got tears in my eyes. I'm standing up. And this lady looks at me and says, is this that emotional to you? And this guy from Boston comes walking across the front of us and says, let him cry because it's never going to happen again, right? We're very bold. Philadelphia people, Boston people are very bold about their passion for their sports town. Even though we're on the opposite end of that a lot of times, we're very similar with the passion that we have for our hometown sports. And listen, take that passion that you have for the Bruins, take that passion you have for the Red Sox, take that passion you have for the Patriots, take that passion you have for the Celtics, and times that by a gazillion and be that bold about the way you talk about Jesus because of what he's done in your life. Know what you believe. And here's number three, share your story. That's what being a witness is. You don't have to be a Bible scholar. You know, we get a little intimidated, right? Because we see Pastor Anthony and knows the Bible so well, and Pastor George knows the Bible so well, and Pastor Matt knows the Bible so well, and Pastor Tom knows the Bible so well, Pastor Greg knows the Bible so well, Holy Reverend Mother Christy Milas knows the Bible so well. You know, all these people you think are biblical scholars, well, they're the ones that need to talk about Jesus. Listen, you don't have to be somebody that has memorized. Now, you should be in your word every day, reading it, applying it, but here's the thing. A witness does what? Tells people something they've personally seen or experienced. Hey man, I was at church one week. The message was unbelievable. The worship was off the chains. But I came in and I heard the story about how I needed to be forgiven of my sins. And I've had a messed up life. And I asked God to forgive me of my sins. And I invited Jesus to come into my life. And now my life has been changed forever. That's called taking the hype of the last 2 weeks and turning it into delivering hope to the community. That's called taking all this excitement that happened in your ministry that's going to impact New England forever and ever and ever and ever, and you owning that. Don't just say Warriors is going to have an impact, but the Warriors that were at the conference are going to have an impact. Just don't say the Shine Conference has an impact, but say the ladies that came home from Shine are going to shine brightly in their community and be a witness of what God did in their life. Share your story. And not that we don't do that for ourselves. We don't do that to make ourselves look better. We do that for God's glory. Here's number four. We're called to be witnesses. Listen, witnesses. People that have personally experienced the life-changing gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Here's what that means, church. That means the gospel is the centerpiece of our lives. Listen, your families, your jobs, your vacations, your money, your pursuit of happiness, all these things, great things about being and living in the United States of America, right? We get all that. But those should not be the most important thing. Are you saying, Pastor Eddie, that my family's not the most important thing in your life? Listen, there's not things that I would put above my family except this, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because here's what the gospel of Jesus Christ has helped me to do. The gospel of Jesus Christ has helped me to be a better husband to my wife, Kim. Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ and my life was changed, it's helped me to be a better father. So by putting Jesus first, that actually helped me to be a better husband, a better dad, a better pastor, a better friend, a better neighbor, right? Without the gospel of Jesus Christ, we're just wandering. And there's a lot of good people out there, right? A lot of good moms and dads, a lot of good husbands, a lot of good wives that have never heard the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. But here's the truth, church. The Bible tells us it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it's according to God's mercy that he saved us. We've got to make sure the gospel is the centerpiece of our life. The gospel is why we send resources to people. Why does your church take offerings for Manna Worldwide and for Convoy of Hope and for Pastor Kim over in North Korea? Why do we do that? Because we want to see other people's lives change with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Church, we ought to look at the gospel the same way that Peter and John did in Acts chapter 4, verse 20, that we can't stop talking about the things that we've seen and heard. Can't stop talking about it. Ought to be the first thing in our mind every day is our relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. Sharing good news. Don't you love sharing good news? I look all the time on Facebook and Instagram, and I'm not doing the TikTok thing yet because I don't have my little swerve thing going. But I look at the social media stuff, and people love sharing. They love sharing weird political stuff, and we're not even going to go into that. But people love sharing good news. I had a good friend that lost 90 pounds, and they put their before picture, woo, and after picture, hooray, up on Facebook so everybody to see why. Because they wanted to share good news. When you have a big birthday, like your pastor Anthony turns Heinz 57 ketchup this year, celebrated his birthday just like you did in the month of March. But there are occasions in our lives that are very, very special. We want people to know about them. A few weeks ago, my wife and I were in Orlando, Florida, and we got to welcome our sixth grandbaby into the world. And his name is Rudy Jacks. And Rudy Jacks was 7 pounds and an ounce. And we showed all these beautiful pictures of Rudy with his mama, Emily, Rudy with his Kiki, my wife, Kim, Rudy with Pop. And we put pictures on. You look at my Facebook, it's a big anthology of the life of being a grandparent, a mediocre pastor, and a mediocre husband. That's what I want my Facebook to look like. I want people to see what? I want them to see good news. I love talking about my family. I love talking about my four girls who I'm very proud of, their husbands who I'm proud of, my grandkids, who I just can't get enough of them. And seeing God work in their lives and watching them grow up is such a great thing. And I'm able to talk about those things because those are things in my life that I personally experience. If you have personally experienced the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ, then this verse is appropriate and ought to be something we celebrate and act on. I can't help but to talk about the things that I've seen and heard. And church, I want to encourage you. May our lifestyles be a true witness, a bold witness of not only what Jesus did at the Shine Conference, and Jesus did at the Warriors Conference, and Jesus is doing in Granite United Church for the cause of Christ all over New England, make it real, real personal. Let me tell you what God's doing in my life. He forgave me, he loved me, and he gave himself for me. Hey, Granite, can I get a witness of some people today whose lives have been changed with the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ? Let me hear you this morning, right? Come on now. Your life has been changed a little bit louder now by the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's raise the roof a little bit, right? Woo! Now listen to me. Let's take that hype and deliver it as hope because we can't stop talking about the things we've seen and heard. Let's pray. Thank you today, Father in heaven, for your life-changing gospel of Jesus. May it be something we think about when we wake up, throughout the day, when we're eating dinner, when we get home at night, when we pillow our head. How can I be a better servant for you? How can I share with people this wonderful, wonderful story? I pray for holy appointments this week for every man and every woman in this room. I pray that you would use this message today to inspire us, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, to be ready to give an answer of the hope that lies within us with meekness and fear. Oh God, please help us so that the very first thing in our thought every day is the gospel, and that we won't stop talking about the things that we've seen and heard. May God use us this week, church, to do something amazing for him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.